Hello everyone, this segment is to let you know that this video contains a Stardock product and was made during the time that I was contracted as a content developer for Stardock Corporation, but was not made under that contract. Thank you for listening, please enjoy the video. Okay, now I can see the game. Hello everyone, welcome to game number one in day two of our Winter FFA Elimination Tournament. We've got Tratping Vin, Kanto, Mr. X, and Tsubak here with us doing the playing. Meanwhile, it'll be me and Terror bringing you commentary today. I can almost talk. Hello, Terror. What's going
Hello.
On and what's up with this map?
Interesting map. So everything's just kind of a little bit awkward, and this cyan spot is kind of interesting from Mr. X. Going with 24k, and there's only the single iron tile. I'm not sure about that. There is a bunch of other patches of iron, one of which Tudeback has found it in. Trat going for the carbon and the scavenger found. He doesn't really have any good aluminum nearby. That's going to be a problem for him. And Trat Pingvin maybe going to struggle a little bit to get that aluminum. He's got a single low on the northwest of his base. Kanto yet to found still.
Yeah, Kanto just being a little bit slow getting going. He does finally found expansive in that northern area next to Mr. X. Mr. X, who has decided, I was wondering if he was going to go for actually the double wind turbine at the start of the game. I don't mind the wind turbine that much, except for the fact that he found it with 24,000 debt. He is, however, just going to go for the wind turbine, steel mill, and aluminum immediately. We'll have to see how that goes for him to get to upgrades. The steel and aluminum will eventually get him there, but it seems like a bit of a slow start for Mr. X after his early found.
Yeah, it's an extremely slow start, and the fact that he founded with 24,000 of debt means really that you can't go into power certainly before HQ2 at the very, very earliest, and HQ1 power is just not going to do anything for you in the short term, and what you need when you're HQ1 is a short-term benefit to get yourself to HQ2.
Tubac's not going to make him anything's easier on him. Anything easier on him for the time being. Oh. Tubac's going to take away the
Ouch.
High water, the medium water nearby, that's just going to make things difficult for Mr. X, even after he manages to get up to his a bit slow HQ2.
Yeah, and it makes Tudeback's spot a lot better, actually. The fact that he has that 5 water a second coming in now from relatively close range. He's got the iron there, he's got the aluminum there, he's got the silicon there in case he needs that. This is looking like a really good expansive spot.
Yeah,
after
like a
all
fantastic
that.
Fantastic location. I mean, he doesn't yeah. have carbon available anywhere, from what I can tell, but I think that most of that is going to be in the hands of Trat anyway, and carbon scrubbing is always available on Mars, so shouldn't be too much of an issue for him long term. Just a little sad to miss out on that resource.
Yeah, absolutely. The one thing that Trat is going to have going for him is the fact that it is a chem colony, so, and there have actually already been two additional laboratories placed under the colony as well, so 1.4 per second is the demand, and that's going to make it very easy for him to make a lot of money very quickly with the water nearby, with the carbon very nearby as well, and he's going to be looking at that as a potential income stream in the long term. He's going for the two wind turbines, so looking perhaps to make something of a power play here. Power is kind of plateauing at the moment with the production from Mr. X as well, but you have to say Tudeback, with a very fast early start, he's certainly in the lead at this point in the game.
Absolutely. I mean, he can hit HQ level 3 anytime he wants, and he goes ahead and does. No problem whatsoever. Got access to some decent aluminum, another medium aluminum auctioning off. Maybe not the one that Tubac would have liked to see, but it could help out Mr. X a bit moving forward here. It does look like Tubac's going to be expanding into some additional steel. Not a bad idea when one of the other steel users is a little bit light. This game in particular, also going to make the move into reactors. Reactors potentially allowing him a convenient path forward on into chemicals later on, if he can keep that fuel price in check. So things looking good for Tubac early on.
Yeah, potentially. He's taken, He's taken a second aluminum mine that's not adjacent to the one that he has
that's
right now.
That's the auction tile. That's our tile.
Oh, that's the auction. Oh, excuse me. Okay, yeah. My apologies. But yeah, the aluminum situation for Tudeback looking pretty good. That might be kind of an okay resource in the short term. Everyone full price on aluminum this game. Kanto only has really the one low, what's Trat working off? He's working
he's
off the two lows.
Yeah, I didn't really like the fact that he had to commit two tiles to it, but I think it might have been a reasonable decision. Thing is, Trat, he's going to have to be moving very quickly with these two aluminum tiles. It's very, very good for him, potentially, that there are extra claims available on the market, because he's going to need them in the late game to keep up with somebody who got off to the races like Tubac did.
Yep, and Trat Ping then with the three reactors, and he did freeze out Tubac's reactors as well, so good proactive securing of that particular market, trying to get as much glass as possible before this shortage that he knew was coming. And that's going to propel him into a slightly early cash lead over Tubac. Tubac looking instead maybe to have to pay off some of that debt in the short term. He's got the geo, so he is okay for the time being, but it is a little bit of a concern. And also, Trat's making power money.
Yes, Trat with those two wind turbines, of course, being a scavenger, didn't have to worry about power prices in the early game. Yeah, the electrolysis reactor's got a little bit in the way of that, but I imagine he's not too concerned about it, considering power's at a modest $126, $125 right now. Also going to be expanding into farms. Interesting. Well, that didn't really work out all that well, but at least his reactors are still online.
Yeah, but it's eaten an EMP that Tubac might have preferred to use on the reactors instead. I'm not exactly sure, but in any case, doesn't have access to that food income for a while. But I don't think you'll be too concerned. That power is a decent amount of money for him in the short term. They're making, 140 a second on power, which is a very good income stream, despite the fact that power is falling. Konto falling a little bit behind, unfortunately. He's got that geo, which is kind of tying up at least one of his claims. He's got some food coming in, which is going to help him a lot, but he's still some distance, unfortunately, from the upgrade, just because that glass is so expensive.
Absolutely. Expensive glass, and not really helping the situation with getting these farms online. I do wonder if it might be preferable for him to have gone into some glass instead. He's got the silicon secured that he needs very easily, just to make it directly, rather than the food in particular, with this dust storm on the way. I think a move like that is what I would have rather seen. But Konto, hopefully he'll be able to get up to three before too long. That would let him very easily expand into glass himself. I do find it interesting, people building farms with this dust storm coming in, when you've got maybe chemicals as an okay source of cash, glass kilns is a fantastic source of cash, and actually Trat is going to make the change. Gives up on the food before it actually builds. He's going to head right into that nice profitable glass. I think that sets Trat up very well to head to HQ5. Have to see what ends up happening, though.
Yeah, completely fair enough. I think Tubac has made a mistake going into those farms. Just as soon as the dust storm hits, the farms come online. That's not going to do him any favors at all. And he's not in that very profitable glass market. Konto, I think, is going to be looking to do that as soon as he hits HQ3 as well. He's got a big stockpile of silicon that he's been collecting from that high tile, which is now a farm. But certainly the early profits in the glass race are with Trat Ping Bin. He's making money off his power still. It's not a lot of money, but it's some money. And glass is really good. The reactors are okay. And he now has a significant cash lead, as well as not being in any debt.
Trat Ping Bin finding a way to attack literally all of his opponents with a single EMP there. It looks like it might have landed on the water pump for Tubac. I don't see that getting anything done anytime soon, but there is a concern that with all this life support flying up for so many players, water could eventually get out of control. So if you focus on it, in particular with some underground nukes and EMPs, there is an opportunity there to try and squeeze people out of that market.
Yep, I think so. Mr. X has disconnected, unfortunately, so he is not going to be a factor in this game. He's not much... He wasn't all that relevant anyway, to be completely honest. But he is going to be an AI for the time being. The dynamite drops on the Pleasure Dome, which Tubac had put down, which is no great surprise with power at that price. Too expansive in the game. That was a very good Pleasure Dome. And Tubac spotting that out almost immediately.
You're on your own again. Unfortunately.
Ah, right, yeah. So, yeah, you were breaking up for me, so I wondered if that was your end or my end, but yeah. My stream, welcome along. Thank you, Philothanic, for directing traffic in this direction. A Pleasure Dome auction is coming up as well. And Tubac in all of that has hit HQ5, which is really nice for him. still in a bunch of debt. And Trap Pingvin gets the Pleasure Dome auction, so he's going to have two Pleasure Domes that he's working off. Wonder if he's going to be tempted to get a patent along with that. Mr. X, as I've said, out of the game. And Trap Pingvin trying to take advantage of the fact that Toadback has committed to that upgrade. Is very, very close to taking Toadback out of the game. I think he's going to do it as well. Does have the cash, or very close to the cash, on hand. And I think with this purchase, there's the majority buy. I think with this purchase, that's probably game number one going over to Trap Pingvin. Konto's still quite far behind. Trap Pingvin has the subsidiary, the HQ5 subsidiary, no less. And the big stock price lead, the two Pleasure Domes. And Ich bin ein Konto now has hit HQ4. But Trap Pingvin hit HQ5. And it's, I think, going to be very, very difficult to overhaul this deficit, even with the expansive advantage that you're going to have in the late game. Trap Pingvin putting up the patent lab. So I wonder if we're going to see virtual reality. I imagine we probably are. A couple of nukes dropping on the water of Ich bin ein Konto. So trying to get control of that market. Konto, they are his only water tiles, and they're now two trace level water tiles as well. So only the 0.76 of water coming in from Konto. He is putting up a solar condenser where his, I think, wind turbine was on the cliff just there. But nothing really doing for him. He has all of these farms, and they're rapidly losing profitability because he doesn't have the water to support them.
Yeah, things definitely not looking good for Konto. I'm caught up again at this point. As you were saying, Trat just did a fantastic job this game, let's be honest, so far. Choosing to hold off on his upgrade until he had finished off his primary threat on the opponent, that's just... it's not something you see very often, and I do believe it's what we had here today. You just really, really good job of Trat identifying the problems that he needed to handle and making sure he was in a position to get it done. Not every player can do that in an FFA.
And he's doing the exact same thing to Ich bin ein Konto, who upgraded to HQ5, and as soon as he did, Trat Pingvin all over that, gets the 5 stock, is going to get the 6 stock very soon indeed, as soon as the 5-second cooldown runs down. And that is going to be game number one to Trat Pingvin. Very, very good performance from him. Toadback with a strong start, but just overextending slightly with that expansive found, with that HQ5 upgrade. Did look to be in a good position, but Trat Pingvin taking it out very, very ably indeed. Yeah. Trat asking if we're counting this one. I'm pretty sure we are, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, we're well past bounding. I do believe that typically, after everybody gets on the board these days, we call it a game afterward.
Yeah, I think that's fair enough. And honestly, Mr. X,
we were well
had kind of a difficult start. Yeah, we were. And he had kind of a difficult start and wasn't necessarily going to be threatening either of Toadback or Trat Pingvin in that game. So I think we can be comfortable in calling this one. And yeah, as we said, Toadback, that was a really strong found, particularly with those two water tiles that you managed to pick up. But ultimately, it was the carbon, it was the chems advantage that Trat Pingvin got, and he used the black market to very good effect as well.
Absolutely.
A very accomplished game from him.
Yeah, he did a great job making sure to focus on the opponent he needed to bring down. There were a couple black market uses in there that maybe weren't 100% optimal, but at least you know what it is you want to accomplish, and you're trying to go ahead and use your cooldown consistently. You need to do that as a scavenger. Very, very helpful for Toadback in a lot, for Trat in a lot of ways, I do believe, that he really did just have one opponent at a time he needed to worry about. Mr. X and Konto were both lagging behind all game, so Toadback made for a nice, clear target for Trat at least, but he picked it well. He knew what he needed to get done. As you said, an overextension by Toadback pretty much just gives Trat the game at that point.
Yeah, and just looking at the black market situation, Trat Pingvin, 9 black market purchases. 3 of them EMPs, 2 of them nukes, and 2 of them claims as well. We hadn't mentioned the fact that there were claims on the black market. That does tend to help anyone who's not yeah, anyone who's not expansive, really, that's a good thing for them, because it gives them access to claims that they very much need throughout the game. But that's game number one. Let's head into game number two.
Yep, pretty quick game. Not too much more to talk about there. Okay, hello everyone. Welcome to game number two. Our second day of this FFA elimination tournament. Gonna have Trap Ping Vin, Mr. X, Kanto, and Tudeback here once again doing the playing. And Terra is still around for some additional commentary after that initial Trap Ping Vin win. So, hello, and there's one green price. There's one green price this time around, and I'm seeing a lot of red.
Yeah, the power is green, everything else pretty much red. It's a glass colony, so wonder if our players will be tempted to forego any early advantage and maybe make sure they're near some of that silicon, even though glass is starting at $40, because it might be that it's a big factor in this game. Nobody's seeing anything they like, though. Right up until the zero mark, Trap Pingvin takes the scavenger spot in the southwest for no debt. This is good, but I'm a little bit concerned about his warduper situation, particularly as Konto's scientist found is going to take those two water tiles that were otherwise looking very attractive.
Look at this spot in the east. Look, there's no iron over here. There's only a little bit of carbon over here. But look at this. You've got aluminum, you've got water, you've got silicon. I was really, really hopeful we'd get something crazy this game. Like somebody drops scientist and just drops solar panels next to it, tries to work on the silicon that's in the area so that you can prepare to move into glass, because it's a glass colony later on. Steel started at 30. You can still get to your upgrade easy. That's what I wanted to see, but nobody felt like doing the crazy thing this game. It just disappoints me a little bit.
Yeah, there really is no iron anywhere near, though. It's a big risk when you do that.
Iron is for weaklings.
Well, Noxie, I guess, would agree with you after game two yesterday. Went into that power robot.
And she won. Just saying.
There you go. So Trap Pingvin with the early lead. Tudeback was actually first to HQ2 with that scientist, getting water in now as well as that high aluminum tile that's quite close by. Konto was hot on his heels with those three steel mills that are consuming a lot of power and are not being all that profitable right now, but again, scientists making steel is just kind of what you have to do, and Konto has claimed the high water as well, so he's going to get that, at least in the short term, away from Trap Pingvin, who I'm sure was eyeing it to some extent as well. Mr. X struggling a little bit, making that steel early, does have the upgrade and takes it now, and so we'll see what he's going to do with the HQ2 claims. He's going to get a few of them as an expansive player. Takes some carbon.
Yeah, worth noting that one of the reasons that Mr. X was so slow to HQ2 was that he did go ahead and use a black market cooldown immediately this game to grab a claim. So he was actually operating on aluminum, iron, and steel, which I generally don't prefer that. I like to get to HQ2 first, but at least there is a decent reason for him being a little late to the upgrade compared to everybody else.
Yep, and I think it's probably a mistake, just given the prices were so low and you're not really going to get much out of that claim in the short term. And also it's going to be quite expensive for you. Even 2,000 with a low price environment like this one is difficult to justify.
Absolutely.
But Trap Pingvin getting first to HQ3, and again, he doesn't have any debt. He's got those two wind turbines. Playing this scavenger very, very well, getting that extra aluminum money as well in the short term.
Certainly.
And he's making quite a lot of money off this power.
Yeah, power's doing really well for him. He got it down at HQ2, usually something that's not advisable in most situations. But as we pointed out at the start of this game, power was the only expensive resource. Almost everything else was dead. Very difficult to pull in a profit off anything else until some demand gets going from both the colonies and then life support of the players themselves, as well as the upgrade costs. So power, really the only reasonable thing, made a lot of sense this time around, and Trap, he's once again going to be taking the lead in upgrades this game. Gets a claim auction for 10,000. Is everybody else asleep at the wheel?
Yeah, I mean, normally you don't really want to be taking claim auctions when you are making power money, because that is basically cash that you're paying for it. But I think in this case, 10K as a scavenger is really hard to turn down.
Certainly. I mean,
he'll be very happy with that.
Through most of it again already. He's already secured chemicals that he can use to upgrade to 4. So he's going to be just fine. And once again, that's a whole claim without a black market cooldown. Meanwhile, he just bought another claim for 6,000 using the cooldown. So I think he's more than fine with paying that 10.
Yeah, racing through these upgrades. He only really has the glass to worry about. He's getting 7 aluminum a second from the adjacent aluminum to his base. And those two carbon that are close by as well, doing a lot of work for him. It's also worth quite a bit of money now. I guess just because he's been upgrading so, so quickly.
I do wonder if we're going to see an optimization center down from him before too long, though. One of my big concerns about Trat is the idea that he is positioned very far away from all this silicon. He's having to ship some in. He only has one tile for now. He might need to commit to a second tile. Nothing's going to be high. I do wonder what we're going to see him do to compensate for that, because he has already moved into the glass at this point.
Yeah, a lot of black market coming down on Konto's geotherm. Couple of mutinies and then an EMP. But yeah, you're right about the silicon. It's a little bit of a concern. I mean, he's getting some in and fuel's not all that expensive just yet. So I think he's okay dealing with that for the time being at least. And he's making that glass now as well. And glass, really, really good.
Up to HQ5 if he'd like it already. I do wonder if he's going to go for it now or if he's going to go ahead, wait, see what he can get done. I feel like after being frozen, you kind of want to take the upgrade just to get some more tiles back online. Pushing for a kill when you've got 5 tiles offline from that EMP, not usually a desirable choice, but we'll see what Trat decides to do with it. He is going to upgrade.
Yep, he does upgrade. It's absolutely safe because nobody else has any more than 25k in cash. Konto takes his HQ4 upgrade, but really everyone in this game quite far behind Trat Pingvin, who is looking to take what might be the fastest Elimination FFA series we have ever seen, if this one reaches a swift conclusion.
Yep. That said, when you are this far ahead of everybody else, there's really no doubt in anybody's mind who needs to be taken down. And so we're going to have to see if they keep up with these EMPs and mutinies. Not a whole large number of black market items you can be aggressive with, but there are a few, and if you can knock the scavenger down, drive things to the late game, I think the expansives and the scientists are going to be favored at that point. They just have to manage to get there this time around.
Yeah, one of the luxuries of being HQ5 as well is that you can put a pleasure dome down basically whenever you want. You can spare the claim to do that. Konto putting down a patent lab. Oh, is it a patent lab? It's an
optimization center. No, it is a patent lab. That looks like an optimization center.
Yeah, no, it's a patent lab. And Trat deciding to do the same thing. He's going for that teleportation, which I think makes a lot of sense in the context of this silicon situation.
Yep. He's also in a bit of an odd position. It looks like, Trat did manage to secure 2 silicon tiles. Don't like to have to do that as a scavenger, but it seems he's picked up plenty of extra claims so far this game, so I don't think it's going to hurt him that much. Meanwhile, Konto, maybe with a bit of a misselection for his silicon tile, although he's going to be trying to use it now, getting a mutiny in on some of Trat's silicon. Both players really fighting over that one little segment of silicon.
Yeah, absolutely. And only one claim for Trat Pingvin on the black market. He's got that second one, of course, from the auction.
Auction, yeah.
But making sure that he's aggressive. Oh, and Konto is also working on teleportation, but he's going to be slower. Trat Pingvin is going to get it.
Yep, even that scientist advantage, and it is goon squatted, so nothing anybody can do about that. Trat has teleportation secured for this game.
Yep, despite the EMP coming down from Tudeback on the reactors, which again is a really good EMP. I think Trat is going to have a bunch of black market raining down on him. But he's in that sort of position again. He's got enough money that he's at least going to be making everyone else uncomfortable about upgrading.
Yeah, they're going to be very slow to getting 5.
Yeah, Mr. X gets himself to HQ4, and even that was a little bit dangerous. Trat Pingvin with some amount of the money to buy him out. Oh, a mutiny goon from Trat Pingvin on Konto's patent lab. He now has control of 2 patent labs. That was really cute.
Yep, worked out quite well for him. And he had thinking machines queued up. He was already researching virtual reality. I think he even has an additional patent queued up now, perpetual motion, that he's going to be trying to get a hold of. Just patents everywhere for Trat this game. He's trying to secure that late game, it seems. Make sure that even if these players get up to 5, they're going to have to struggle against some powerful tools he'll have available.
Yeah, completely fair enough. He's got the two silicon tiles as well, which I think in the late game will be quite an advantage given the glass demand from the colony.
Tubac has secured a lot of silicon himself. He's actually got three tiles, but will not have access to teleportation to help them out. And as a scientist, that's not really a spot you want to be in.
Yeah, you want to be using something else to get that silicon to you. That's a bunch of freighters in the air. There are magnetic storms. No pirates, but magnetic storms might ruin your day. And certainly if they ever become glass kilns rather than silicon quarries, the magnetic storm concerns will be very, very real.
Yeah, and the big issue here is there's, even if you transition them into glass kilns, it's all well and good. Maybe glass looks profitable at the time. Takes forever to actually make any glass. Magnetic storm's potentially going to knock it down. They're so far away, you can't transition the tiles easily no matter what. I mean, there's just a whole host of problems with having to take silicon like this game. And I'm kind of curious if Tubac, he's going to make electronics out there. Yeesh.
Yeah, it's a little bit difficult, isn't it? It's difficult. It's not much he can do. He doesn't have many claims close to his base at all. They're all remote. Wonder if he was banking on that teleportation. But far too slow to the punch. It's worth mentioning, by the way, as well, that Trap Pingvin's Pleasure Dome has done so much work. It's very, very, very profitable. It's been the sole Pleasure Dome for a while. He picked up virtual reality as well. And only now, Tubac is getting his own online.
I mean, 438 is going to drop down to 291 for profits, but that is still a fantastic solo tile to have this game. Easily,
yeah.
Probably the best thing that Trat has down, besides maybe this patent lab at this point.
Yeah, possibly the best thing on the map, even.
Okay, Slant Drilling going to be coming out for Kanto now that he has control of his patent lab once again. 37 seconds left on that. Meanwhile, Trat does manage to pick up financial instruments. Probably a nice tool to have with Kanto and Tubac both in the game. They're not looking so hot when it comes to debt, so just a little bit of extra income here and there. Definitely a useful tool. Nanotech going to be the next selection for Trat. Could be useful if the game pushes to Offworlds, although I'll be surprised if people last that long given the position he's in now.
Yeah, he's in such a strong position. Offworlds are reasonable. 520 launches for both food and oxygen right now, but you might be right in that Trat's position is pretty dominant. He's gonna have to really cede a few advantages if anyone else is gonna get back into this game. Here's another claim.
Some of his own stock. Wonder what his plan is. Is he clearly wanted some cash? I'm curious what he's hoping to pull off with selling that stock. That's not something you usually see at this stage of the game.
Yeah, how close is he to an offworld? Not very close. So I wondered if it might have been that, but it doesn't look like it.
No, not really.
So,
he
does
get an EMP down on these farms for Trat.
Yeah, that's going to be quite strong.
Only going to be useful. Slant Drilling coming in for Kanto. Finally going to let him use his farms a little bit more effectively. Most of them now have access to water at this point. Just one hanging out, left away from the pumps.
Yep, Trat with thinking machines. Which, again, and he does get, or Tubac, in fact, gets the nanotech from Trat. So he's going to get that advantage at least. But yeah, so, so many patents. And Trat Pingvin deciding he's going to use that thinking machines right now, putting an offworld down. 41k potential profits from the oxygen launch is pretty good. Difficult to say no to.
Yeah, I find it interesting that Trat didn't bother to pick up carbon scrubbing in particular before going ahead and upgrading. There have been some carbon claims by other people scattered about this map, but not everyone. So it feels like just taking that tool away from a scientist, in particular one shipping out to electronics so far away, could have been a bit useful, especially if you want to move into the offworld markets themselves, which are always going to drive that carbon price pretty high. A little bit of a surprise for me from Trat, but things are still looking great for him.
Yeah, I think they're looking good enough that he's still in a dominating position in this game. These farms are still extremely good. We have a little bit of black market activity. Trat at least making Kanto defend himself, which is going to be a little bit painful for Kanto. And in fact, Trat's, that's not why Trat did that at all. He just wants the very cheap stock while Kanto is in D levels of debt. And he actually is going to be able to finish that buy-up, all else being equal, relatively quickly.
Yeah, he's about 150,000 away from it, and already has the Offworld market fully built. Got the launch going. It's 40 seconds away. Kanto is choosing to buy into Trat's stock, which is not going to help anybody else out this game, unfortunately. Now he's buying into Mr. X. Really not going to help this game, as if and when Kanto gets acquired, Trat will be acquiring all that extra stock for himself.
Yeah, I feel like Tudeback's got the right idea going into Trat Pingvin at this point, making it a two-pronged assault rather than just one, and also making sure that Trat can't just secure the buy on Kanto and in the process secure all of his own stock.
Absolutely.
And well, he's selling out of his sixth pip there as well.
Stock. Wow.
Yeah.
Interesting. Really wants to get Kanto taken down, apparently, and I can't blame him for it. Kanto's a very valuable pickup right now. He's got that slant drilling. He is a scientist. Let's see, he's also actually managed to pick up carbon scrubbing, so that would be a nice subsidiary to have on top of the solid stock boost itself.
Yep, absolutely. Science subsidiary is always good. And Trat Pingvin really trying to get that late game advantage hammered home. He is building a second off-world market, which on the face of it seems okay, but it's a little bit of a risk, I think.
I think it's
It's a very expensive off-world market. He was very close to the buy on Kanto. In fact, he would have the buy on Kanto. In fact, he's seen that. He's cancelled the off-world and taken...
This was a very strange situation to have happen, where Kanto sold out
really
of his own stock, went down
giving
to
him the majority buy, units,
and Tubac got the majority buy onto him. That was that was different, not something that you see every day. This does prevent Trat from getting two claims out of that purchase, which I'm sure Trat would have liked to have. However, he still managed to secure 9 of the stock. Tubac has 1. Currently.
Yeah, it's I don't know, there were definite pluses and minuses there for Trat Pingvin. He could actually, if he wanted to, still have shift clicked and gotten the buy if he really wanted those two claims, but it decides instead to keep most of the money that he would have spent on that. And in the process, I mean, he's not a million miles away, honestly, from the buy on Tudeback. He's got those two off-worlds, one of which is being rebuilt now, having been cancelled the first time. It's not gooned, but again, thinking machines, and also he's got a stock of a mutiny, which is going to be just okay for him. And Tudeback in any case is in the level of debt, so it's really difficult. He does get the mutiny down.
Yeah, he had the mutiny stored up already as this came down. That said, Trat, once again, he has one for himself if he would like to use it, and he even has his cooldown online, so there's nothing Tudeback can do to hold on to this if Trat decides to take it back. Trat's still looking like he's in a great spot here. Only needs about 260,000 more bucks to take out Tubac. Tubac, meanwhile, needs over 500,000 to bring down Trat, who's already up at that $60 stock price, looking just about unassailable from here.
Yeah, he has. Interesting decision not to take the off-world back with his own mutiny, which was already purchased. I think I would have if I were him, but again, not a huge deal. Trat's and Tudeback.
We're going to swing, $80,000. One launch here, one launch there. It's not a huge deal because Trat's lead is just that big.
Yeah, it is. And Tudeback in chat is banging this reveal leader drum once again that he's been doing in Discord as well. But certainly in this case, Trat Pingvin with two very, very strong games, getting out to an early lead in certainly the second one. Not so much in the first one, but... And I don't feel like it was his lead was very clear, so I'm not sure it would have changed too much having the reveal leader option.
I mean, look, it might have in some ways, but that's disgusting anyway, and I'm never going to cast a game where that's going on.
Yeah.
In any case, I mean, let's be honest. I think every single player who wasn't Trat this game messed up on founding. I genuinely think that because steel was $30 and they all put down at least 2 steel mills. Don't do that.
Yep, we've seen it a lot, and we've seen it again this game. So this is going to be probably a Sol 8 win for Trat Pingvin. So a Sol 5 win and a Sol 8 win. And I would imagine that if we go back into the history books of FFA elimination tournaments, can't imagine we're going to get too many quicker series than this one.
No, and Trat, he is definitely looking like he's going to be in a position to go ahead and get that done whenever he'd like. He has the cash to finish off 2-to-back. Now all he's got to do is bring down Mr. X. Mr. X has been very kind and constructed an off-world market that Trat could assault if he would like to. Doesn't look like he's going to go that route this game, though. Still just sitting here with an array of black market options and the cooldown available. Trat can, however, sell down out of his stock very easily. Mr. X, no threat whatsoever. Gonna give him all the cash he needs to get this done very quickly this game.
Yep, and if he sells out of his two stocks, he gets, what, 150k or so from that, maybe a little bit more. Only then needs another 50, and in fact, even if he wanted to, he could sell out of all of his own stock
and get the buy.
Yeah, he's totally fine. So Mr. X with the mutiny on the off-world market. Again, it's not gonna do a whole lot.
Nope. And we do, there in fact, is. See the sell down to 6. That's going to give the buy to Trat. Takes the game the series very rapidly.
A very quick 2-game series. The second 2-game series in succession. Noxie yesterday and Trat Pingvin today. We'll see them in the final next weekend. But again, just that... I mean, a few mistakes from 2-back, and I think it was in both games, as we said... Perhaps before the cast, I think we both sort of identified Trat and 2-back as the two favorites, and it kind of was the story of both games.
Yep,
they got out to a lead.
I mean, Trat got out to a lead immediately in both games. 2-back, he was quite far ahead of other people in game one, lagging behind a bit in game two. I think because of this strange founding location, dropping scientist with only the iron really available to you immediately. You have to be extremely careful with buildings separated from your base, so many of them separated from your base as a scientist. That just slows you down by so much. I think it takes people by surprise sometimes, this idea that you've got $10,000 sitting over there that if you had it here right now, you could upgrade. And so you're going for like 20 seconds without upgrading where you could have if they were next to you, right? And then that magnifies itself later where it happens again, and it's happening in part because you didn't upgrade earlier, and so you end up 10 seconds here, 20 seconds there. All right, well, you're 3 minutes behind, and that's way too far to keep up.
Yeah, it is definitely the nature of these type of games, of 4X games in general, that advantages early snowball into advantages later, because you're able to do so much more quickly, and that definitely was the case. And again, those steel mills early on in this game with steel at $30 costing a lot of these players because... You know, you can just buy steel.
It's
so cheap. Just buy it.
I really wanted somebody to drop in the silicon water patch that we had over there. You had great aluminum. Mm. You got water and silicon right there. Yeah, you gotta buy steel. Whatever. People were making steel. I mean, let's go. I'm actually gonna go. We're gonna go to charts and graphs. I'm gonna go to resource prices. Look at this steel price. Look at this steel price. Look at how tiny it is. Mm. Even in the middle of the game, around Sol 5, yeah, it got up to like $120. Steel always does that. You just get it in its low points, because it's going to hit low points too, and you're fine. Look at how low this steel price was this game, though. That's pretty low for a steel graph.
It's very low indeed, and the fact that, the players didn't really recognize that. I mean, Trat sort of sidestepped the issue by going for the very strong scavenger, and the fact that Trat got this scavenger with no debt, I think, was a big deal as well, because on the face of it, there wasn't a whole lot to dissuade anyone from taking this scavenger spot. The only thing was the water, and he had enough water. He had the two low tiles, in fact the three low tiles that were a little way away, but certainly that was enough for the time being. And the fact that there was so much aluminum, there was so much carbon, and everything else close by just meant that it was a really strong location, particularly with that steel situation.
It was. Well, and as you pointed out, especially with no debt, that was actually a crucial part of what Trat was doing this game, was management found with zero debt. Because if he had not gotten into power on HQ2 and been able to make money from it, he would not have been able to accelerate through upgrades this quickly. I mean, glass started off low. The warehouses were there, though, so they were going to be driving that price up constantly. It was basically no other way to properly make money on this map. It was just in the power. And so being able to get into that onto and actually start making money from it, that was absolutely huge. And that's really what gave Trat the advantage that he exploited through the rest of the game to eventually take the win.
Yeah, didn't have to farm with any debt, and that was really the big implication of that in the longer term. Because, yeah, HQ2 power money, HQ3 power money, and we've seen a bunch of these games already in this Elimination FFA decided with those HQ3 power plays. Noxy yesterday, and again, Trat Pingvin today. So that's our series, folks. That's we'd settled down into a night of Offworld Trading Company an hour ago, and less than an hour ago, 48 minutes ago, and it's all over after two games. So very well played, Trat Pingvin. He joins Polished Noxy in the final, which will be on Saturday. We have a game tomorrow on the, in fact, a series of games tomorrow on the Stardock stream.
Yep.
So that one will be at 18 GMT, 14 US Eastern. And that series will be between Hexapus, Pavlos, Peasant, and Mega Warrior. I think Hexapus and Pavlos, both very strong players, I think they will start as the two favorites in that series.
I think that's probably true. Peasant has been putting in a lot of work lately. He's certainly been stepping up to be more of a competitor. We'll have to see if he has a chance to prove himself. We'll have a chance to prove himself on Monday, see how that comes through. And then Mega Warrior, not someone we see all that often. So you never know. Mm. Might be a bit of a surprise, but I think I agree with you that in a lot of ways in this group, for me, Hexapus kind of stands out. That's who I see as potentially a danger here. But anybody has a chance to take it tomorrow. We'll just have to see.
Yeah, and then there's Simeus. It's on the Stardock channel. So Zoltar also does some streaming on the Stardock channel on Monday afternoons, yep, Eastern US time, as I said, at 18 GMT at the moment because of the quirk with daylight savings, but 2 p.m. Eastern. And that will be, for this week at least, will be the tournament. And then the final group we have is Tuesday evening at 20 GMT. That's DT, Philothanic, Andreas G, and Tesseract. And I wonder who we might be thinking is the favorite for this one.
Who's the favorite there? Yeah, everybody in Group D, they've got a bit of a monster in DT to try and get through. That said, it's possible. We saw a bit of a surprise a couple weeks ago with the DT Black Magic 1v1. Black Magic knocking Death Tacticus on down to that lower bracket, not where anybody expected him to be. So you never know when the upsets are going to come through, but it's true. Death Tacticus, not an easy player to get past to the finals.
I'm assuming as well that we don't have any 1v1s. It certainly doesn't look like we have any 1v1s to play this evening. So
I haven't seen anything. Bob's away. Andreas is here. I haven't seen Zorbaz at all.
Yeah, what's the other? It's Black Magic DT. Black Magic is DT. The other one.
Yeah, DT's around. Black Magic, it doesn't look like he is, however, so...
Nope, I don't think he is either. So that might be it for tonight, folks. It's a little bit of a truncated program, unfortunately.
Well, that's how it goes sometimes when... In these FFAs in particular, you have to set it at a reasonable stopping point. Two wins, kind of the situation, because if you go to three wins... like 9 games that these players would have to play in order for somebody to get to 3 wins, I think. I mean,
yeah.
And so 5 games is kind of the maximum with 2, and sometimes it goes as low as 2. Even with 3 wins, it could be as low as 3. So just difficult, but that's the way it is when you've got 4 people, unfortunately.
Yep, absolutely. We have to blame our winners for being too good and too consistent with their good play for us to enjoy any more Offworld Trading Company, unfortunately, but...
Could they?
I know. Congratulations to both of them. And I think we're going to call it there, at least for the time being. Keep an eye on the Discord, as per usual, for all of the 1v1 announcements that will no doubt happen over the course of this week. And remember the Stardock stream. It's twitch.tv/Stardock. Which is nice and easy to remember. So put that date in your diary tomorrow at 2 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. UK, and join Zoltar for that series.
don't put it in your diary. That's just weird. I don't want to be in your diary. Maybe on your calendar. Okay. That's all right. But, you know.
Yeah, just set a little reminder or something. That's all. But no diaries, please, by executive request. So, yeah. All right. Well, that'll do it for today.
Yeah, we're out of here, unfortunately. All right. Well, thanks again for joining me. Like I said, I think maybe tomorrow Soren's going to be around. I haven't 100% confirmed that with him. I'm kind of hoping so because I want somebody with me tomorrow with any luck. Just because, of course, of the difficulties that I continue to have. But we'll just have to see. I'm trying to confirm with Soren tonight to see if he'll be around tomorrow, and I'll let people know once I know in the Discord.
Yep, and if you're wondering what we're talking about with the Discord, by the way, Philothanic's got your back. In the chat, there's a link to the OTC Discord. That is the most active off-world trading company community. It is pretty active. And it's the source of all this tournament goodness.
Everything
so,
we're doing today.
You come and join us. Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, otherwise, I'll sign off for now. I won't be casting tomorrow. I'll be watching. But I will be back on Tuesday to do that series with Zoltar as well. So until then, I will sign off for now and see you on Tuesday.
Sounds good. Talk to you later. All right, guys, we're done. We're out 2 games and done. Doesn't quite have the same feeling as one and done, but you get the idea. Trap, a couple very nice victories, very quick victories. A little bit unfortunate for Mr. X having that disconnect in game one, but that is okay. That doesn't take away from Trat's victory. He did very well. He was quite far ahead that game as well. So while the disconnect is unfortunate, I struggle to think that it would have changed the outcome of the game significantly. As discussed earlier, that means we've got 2 players now lined up for our final. And tomorrow we're going to be adding a third. So I hope to see everybody then. But until then, thank you everyone for watching. And I'll see you next time. Thank you.